good morning. I want to greet you on this beautiful spring day that God has given to us. We're enjoying some cooling of temperatures here in the valley, at least for the next couple of days, and then it'll get warmer. It has been a little cooler and windier in the mountain areas. Paul says to the Philippians, "But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly, not that I speak in regard to need, but I have learned to whatever state I am in, to be content. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice." Well, currently we are looking for a way to begin meeting as a physical church again. I have sent out an email and for you to look at. It will be held in the same guidelines of the CDC. We will meet outside the La Casa area. We will bring our own chairs, wear the masks, and keep our distance. It is only for those who feel safe enough to attend. We will still record the service and post each week for those not attending. So please let me know what your preference is of either Saturday night at 6 p.m. or Sunday morning at 8 a.m. I know the temperatures will be a big factor. Please be in prayer over this. We want God's leading in all we do. Now we want to open with a song and a word of prayer.
Just speak his name.
Father, we thank you, God, for this day, for this beautiful day that you've given to us. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for maybe an opportunity of meeting together, to be together physically now. And I pray that you just help us to make the right decisions. Help us to be wise as Solomon, to make the right decisions about coming together. And may you bless us and keep us. And I pray that you'd be in this service today, that you will speak to each one of our hearts. Help us, Lord, as we study about what Solomon said in Ecclesiastes. I pray that you just be with us, I pray, this day. Amen. Well, our scripture today comes from Ecclesiastes, which is the book right after Proverbs. Listen as we hear the words from Ecclesiastes. Well, Ecclesiastes is a misunderstood book of the Bible. This book discusses very relevant questions about the meaning of life. It discusses the futility of life without God. The author is probably Solomon. Ecclesiastes is a commentary on emptiness and inner perplexity. It might be better read from the last chapter to the beginning, because chapter 12 talks about to fear God and to keep his commandments. Ecclesiastes 3, as most of you know, is read a lot at funerals or memorial services, for it speaks about the time to live and a time to die, a season for everything. So it has been said that this is probably written by Solomon in the last days of his life. Listen to the words of Ecclesiastes 4, 7 through 12. And I'm reading from the NIV. Again, I say something meaningless under the sun. He had neither son nor brother. There is no end to his toil, yet his eyes were not content with his wealth. For whom am I toiling, he asks, and why am I depriving myself of enjoyment? This too is meaningless, a miserable business. Two are better than one because they have a good return for their work. But if one falls down, his friend can help him up. But pity the man who falls and has no one to help him up. Also, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. And how can one keep warm alone? Though one day one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. Well, I've entitled this message today, The Saddest Goose. And the reason I title it that is because I read a story recently in the devotional, Our Daily Bread. And it said, the writer says, I was walking into a parking lot. I wondered, what is that football doing in the parking lot? But as I got closer, I realized the grayish lump wasn't a football, it was a goose, the saddest Canadian goose I had ever seen. Geese often congregate on the lawn near my workplace in the fall and in the spring, but today there was only one. Its neck arched back, its head tucked beneath its wing. Where are your buddies? I thought. Poor thing was all alone. It looked so lonely, I wanted to give it a hug. As human beings, we are created for community too. In Ecclesiastes 4:10, Solomon describes how vulnerable we are when we're alone. Pity anyone who falls and has no one to help him up. There's strength in numbers, he added, for though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. And three, a cord of three strands is not quickly broken. This is just as true for us spiritually as it is physically. God never intended us to fly alone, vulnerability isolated. We need relationships with each other for encouragement, refreshments, and growth. In 1 Corinthians 12, it speaks of the importance of the body of Christ working together as one. The body has many parts, but are working together. Together we can stand firm when life's headwinds just come our way. Together. We're going to first talk about the relationships. We are created in God's image to be connected to others. Lots of research has been done showing the effects of relationships. If we lack relationship, our life flounders. From birth, we seek to connect by way of relationships. We are now judged on how many friends we have on social media, whether that be Facebook or Instagram or Twitter or all the other medias. We post this message today, as other churches are doing on Facebook and YouTube and its social media. This is not a bad thing, because we need to connect with each other. But can it be, if it's that's all you're having contact with, is this social media? The average person, it shows in 2017, has 338 friends on Facebook. I'm sure that's higher today. A study published by the journal Royal Society Open Science says we have on an average 5 intimate friends, 15 best friends. Now listen to these numbers. 5 intimate friends, 15 best friends, 50 good friends, 150 friends, 500 acquaintances, and over 1,500 people we may recognize on sight. That's quite a bit. Remembering those names of those 1,500 might be a little difficult for some of us. A new study suggests that fewer than 3% of our friends can be relied on in a crisis. Despite the many ways that humans connect digitally, the percentage of Americans who report feeling lonely has increased greatly, growing from 11% to 20% in the 70s and 80s and 35% in 2010, according to AARP. Social media is not your true friend. They are not the ones to console you in the crisis. Social media friends still keep you alone. Many young people and teens and our youth today are committing suicide because of loneliness. Although they may have many friends on Facebook, they are still lonely. That is sad. So get your head out of your apps and have personal relationships. Don't text someone, call them, or visit them personally. So what really matters? What really matters? Well, let me read to you. We read Ecclesiastes 4 in the NIV. Let me read it to you in the words of the Message. It reads just a little bit different. Starting at verse 7, the Message says, I turned my head and saw yet another wasp of, I turned my head and saw yet another wisp of smoke on its way to nothingness. A solitary person, completely alone, no children, no family, no friends, yet working obsessively late into the night, compulsively greedy for more and more, never bothering to ask, why am I working like a dog, never having any fun, and who cares? More smoke, a bad business. It's better to have a partner than go it alone. Share the work, share the wealth, and if one falls down, the other one helps. But if there's no one to help, tough. Two in a bed warm each other, alone you shiver all night. But yourself, you're unprotected. With a friend, you can face the worst. Can you round up a third? A three-stranded rope isn't easily snapped. A person is not rich if he doesn't have anyone to share the riches with. So I read two is better than one. Verse 9 says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. In Matthew 18:20, it says, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am with them." Where two or three are gathered. Maybe there's a reason for that two or three. So why do you have in your, so who do you have in your life that is lifting you up? Who is making your dreams come to pass? Who will work to make you successful? There are so many that will work to destroy you, but who works to make you better? Then we read in verse 10, "For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up." Interesting. Who do you have in your life that will rally when you fall? I know around in the park we have a lot of people that look out after each other, and if we see someone fall or see somebody that needs help, we come to their rescue and we help them because we love each other and we're family here. But who flees from you when failure comes your way instead of dashing to deliver you? Proverbs 24:16 says, "For a righteous man may fall seven times and rise again." Have you fallen today? Has there been somebody there to help you up? Could it be that due to having real friends who don't just cheer when you win, but when they also comfort you when you crash? I'm reminded of that commercial, and I kind of laugh at it once in a while when I see that elderly lady that falls in the tub and she goes, "Help, help, I'm falling and can't get up." And we look at those commercials and we see the button that they have to push for somebody to come help. How many of us in real life fall and have no one to buzz to come to their help? No one to cry out to when we're suffering, not only in silence, but in isolation. Is that buzzer working for you today? Can you hit that button and one of your friends, your close friends, intimate friends, will come and help you? The scripture says, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself." Be that help buzzer for someone today. Be that help buzzer. When somebody says, "Help, help, I've fallen and can't get up," you go to their rescue. 3 John 1:2 says, "Dear friend, I hope is all is well with you and that you are as healthy in body as you are strong in strength." Help each other not only physically but spiritually today. Now in verse 11 it says, "Two in bed warm each other, alone you will shiver all night." Now some may look at that and think that's a sexual thing, but I look at it as being insulation. Are we there to help and to warm each other and to keep us each other from freezing and shivering? Friends that really know you are the ones you're looking for. Friends that will act as a buffer when you're worried. Friends that are a barrier when you're depressed. Friends who insulate you and protect you from outer voices or inner voices. Friends who insulate you from you. Friends who listen to your own doubts and fears. God's friends, prayer partners, prayer warriors. Be a prayer warrior or a prayer partner for your closest friends, for each other. That is important. Verse 12 says, "By yourself, you're unprotected. With a friend, you can face the worst." How many of us have looked at that? In our deepest, darkest times, we feel so unprotected. We feel so vulnerable. Who is it that is your shield or your protector or your help today? I think of Job. His friends were not there to protect him. They were to criticize. They were to look down on him. He must have done something wrong. They weren't there to uplift him. Think of Job. Also, you need someone who will stick to you every day, including your worst day. Remember the story of the Good Samaritan? Samaritans were not the type of people that you'd want to have any association with. But yet, after everyone else passed the man on the side of the road that had been beaten and bruised, the Samaritan is the one that stopped, took him to safety, binded his wounds, gave money to the innkeeper, and said, "Do everything you can for this man." He was loving his neighbor as himself. Romans 12:10 says, "Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves." Listen to that again. Honor one another above yourselves. In Romans 12:15-16, now this is also in the Message, I'm reading it from the Message. It says, "Laugh with your happy friends when they're happy. Share tears when they're down. Get along with each other. Don't be stuck up. Make friends with nobodies. And don't be a great somebody." Let me read that again. Laugh with your happy friends when they're happy. Share tears when they're down. Get along with each other. Don't be stuck up. Make friends with nobodies. That's people that you don't necessarily see that has friends. You need to become their friend. Don't be the great somebody. Look at me, what I've done. Your Facebook friends list may be huge. Your Twitter audience may be massive. Your Instagram may bulge with viewers. But can you stop this morning and ask this question? Are you feeling alone together? Are you feeling alone together? Can you think of someone you can call in the middle of the night and they will respond? Is there anyone in your life who is providing the benefits listed here in Ecclesiastes? This pandemic lately has left us all alone. We can't get out. We're isolated. Have you spent time in God's Word? Have you spent time on your knees praying? Have you made a phone call? Phone calls are okay. You can make a phone call to somebody. You can talk to them personally on the phone instead of texting. Are you connecting with your special friends? Folks in nursing homes are left there to exist. They are alone. Your loved ones in the hospitals now can't have friends, can't have anybody coming to see them. They are alone. What a horrible feeling that is, to be alone. Keep in touch with those around you. Spend time in prayer. Develop these personal relationships, even over the phone or at a distance. I miss being in a physical church to where I can shake hands and hug people. I am on a group of friends on Facebook with fellow pastors, and one pastor shared just the other day that a funeral home director came and asked him, "We have a family here that needs someone to preach the funeral of this deceased loved one. Would you come and do it?" And he said, "Yes, I will." And the director looked at him and said, "I have asked other pastors and no one wants to get involved. No one wants to get involved. Pastors don't want to get involved because of the pandemic." And this gentleman, this pastor that wrote this, said he went to the funeral and he held a service for this lost one. And the widower came up to him afterwards and said, "May I shake your hand? I appreciate what you did and the words you said, and thank you so much for being here for us." And others came up and shook his hand and said, "Thank you. Thank you so much." Are we doing that today? Are we so scared of this virus that we're letting people be alone and not having anybody there to speak to them and to help them. Jesus said in the scripture, Jesus answered them and said, "The first of all commandments is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord with your love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with your strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like to this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." No commandment greater than these. You know, I want to challenge you today. I want to challenge you today that you go off and assess who are your five most intimate friends and who are the next 15 best friends, and cultivate and enrich these relationships with them starting today. Starting today. And then look at those around you that are without friends, the friendless, the homeless, the people that really need you to shake their hands or even virtual hugging, whatever that may be. Pray for them. Read scripture together. Listen to their heart's needs. Know them intimately. What are they going through today? Pick them up when they fall. Help! Help! I've fallen and I can't get up and I have nobody that'll be here to help me. Be that person today. Be that life alert buzzer. We see them all around, especially with us older people. We see that buzzer hanging off of somebody's neck. Be that buzzer for somebody. So any time of day or night, they can buzz you and say, "Help, I've fallen and I need you to help me get up. I need you to help me get up." And last of all, love them. So you have your task for this week. Assess who these people are and work on your relationship to get closer to them in your relationship. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this message today from Solomon to each one of us. Lord, we see people around us today that are alone, that are lonely, and even though they may have multitude of people on Facebook, they are still alone. They're looking for somebody. They're looking for hope. They're looking for love. They're looking for a Savior that will help them and guide them and direct them, Lord. They need someone to help them get up when they've fallen. They need somebody that's a friend that will get off the computer, get off the Facebook, and just call. Call and talk to them. Lord, I pray that you would just help us this week as we evaluate who our five intimate friends are, our next 15 friends, and those out there that do need a friend, and help us to cultivate this relationship this week, starting today. I pray that you just be with us, guide us, give us the wisdom of Solomon. Solomon wrote this scripture, Lord, for us, for me today. And I ask that you just help us to be able to follow his direction and get the wisdom from you, Lord, that we need each and every day. And I pray these things in your precious name. Amen. Well, live a life today that is peace in our Lord Jesus Christ. May the grace of the Lord be with you today as you go. And remember, most of all, pray for each other. Amen. See you next time.